Hey folks, Sam here with Samwood Outdoors. Another quick video to help you get the most accuracy you can get out of your pellet guns. Now mostly what we're going to talk about is brake barrel guns today and how to hold them. And some things that have occurred that people don't understand. Okay, first of all, we've all had the pump up air guns, the 2100, you know, the old, just the pump guns. These guns doesn't have the double recoil. That's why back in the day, we used to be able to buy a scope that was made for an air gun or a 22. Back then, they were a little less expensive. You could buy them guns and they would hold up great on these. Nowadays, we're into these brake barrel guns, these PCP guns. The PCP guns are basically the same as these. You can put any scope you want on here. Air gun rated scopes work a little bit better because they're a little bit more durable, but they don't have this double recoil that we got in these brake barrel guns. Basically what I'm talking about is the recoil in these guns is double recoil. It goes forward, then backwards. If you cock this gun, whether it's a nitro piston gun, a spring gun, a gas spring gun, a gas piston gun, whatever they're calling them or what their technology is using for that specific type of gun or brand name gun, you're basically cocking a spring or a bunch of gas and it's held back. Now, when you pull the trigger, a couple things happen. First of all, that spring or that gas ram plunges forward and pushes a plunger and compresses the air. And when that hits the end of its stroke, the gun goes forward. The pellet hasn't even left the barrel, and we already got the recoil starting. Then, when the plunger bounces back or the spring bounces back a little bit, and the pellet leaves the gun, that gas is compressed and it's just getting less, then we'll have this recoil backwards. I'm gonna show you in slow motion. I don't know how much the camera's gonna pick up, but it really makes the rear recoil very violent because it's moved forward and then it gets slammed back. So a lot of you guys think your scope is shit. You go out, you buy a different scope, you don't buy an air gun rated scope, and they get destroyed. I don't care which one you get. You go buy a couple hundred dollar Leupold scope. If it's not air gun rated, don't buy the old rimfire air gun scopes. Them can't even take this recoil. Them are made for your pump up guns. Little cheaper models, little less easier on the pocketbook, but they cannot handle this violent recoil or this double recoil, the forward back recoil. You have to get air gun rated scopes. Most manufacturers that are selling brake barrel air guns are selling a scope that is rated for that. But you can put a Gammo scope on a Crossman. You can put a Crossman, a Center Point, which is made by Crossman, is owned by Crossman, on a Gammo. And there's a bunch of other ones out there. Another thing that happens in that recoil is you'll see I have these scope mounts pushed right up to that turret. The scope mounts are right up to that turret. You'll notice if you spread your scope mounts and you don't have it on that turret, that this scope in that recoil, when that gun moves forward, this is kind of wants to stay because of the mass. And the bigger the scope, the worse it is. You start getting up in these bigger scopes here. It kind of wants to stay in place, and you'll watch, and your scope will actually start sliding backwards on your gun. So I like to mount my scopes with the turrets right up next to that rear mount and then adjust my scope forward and backward with on the rail. That really helps. Sometimes it's kind of hard because some of these guns have the stud that goes down through the scope mount into the gun and into a little hole on the gun to help it hold it and do that. That just kind of messes me up. I don't use that because what happens is I try to get this as tight as I can, but what happens is if I use that, then I gotta adjust forward and backwards to get the correct distance, the correct eye relief on my scope. And it doesn't take long shooting this gun, and it ends up, the scope moves. It's an inherent problem. I get it. I tried to put a little piece of sticky tape inside the rings. There's other things you can do. Try to avoid using just do what you can to mount the scope. Keep an eye on it. Make sure it doesn't move on you. But anyways, so enough about scopes. That's an inherent problem. Something you're going to have to watch. Something you're going to have to understand about these guns is that right there. Next thing I want to talk to you about. Well, actually, let's get to the slow motion footage of shooting that 25 caliber right there.
You can see the gun take a slight forward recoil and then a jolt backwards, and that's due to the spring stopping the forward recoil and starting the backwards recoil so hard.
Okay, now you've seen that violent recoil. So now let's talk about hold. One thing that you need, if you want to become a very, very good pellet, break barrel pellet gun shooter, and this will actually help you in a lot of your other shooting, is to learn the artillery hold. Artillery hold. Let's think about the olden days. We've seen the cannons and stuff fire in the artillery. Boom! And the whole thing would roll backwards on the carriage. And then they would push it forward, get it in the same spot. Boom! Shoot in it, roll backwards. And they'd push it forward, get it in the same spot. Basically, later on, you start to see the guns where the barrel moves. Basically, what they're doing is they are making the carriage part of the recoil. And they do it over and over and over the exact same way. So when that gun moves, it's the projectile's leaving the barrel in the same spot. The barrel's in the same spot every single time. And then they push it back and they start over. Basically, the same thing here. When the barrel, on the newer artillery, when the barrel kind of goes inside the carriage and then goes back out, the pellet is leaving the barrel at the same time. With these break barrel guns, that recoil is starting before that pellet ever leaves the gun. So that equates to the artillery hold being very, very important. So you'll see me when I sight in, or you'll see me bench shooting these guns in a lot of the videos. I always first put something very soft under the gun, especially if I'm shooting off of some sort of rest or vise. Don't ever put your gun in a vise. If you lock your gun in a vise, basically what you've done now is you've created, the vise has become part of the gun and the recoil is not being absorbed and your gun will shoot like shit. It's just a horrible thing to do. You want to shoot in basically one of these, or sandbags are really, really good. And basically what you want to do, like I said, I always put a rag under here when I shoot. And you've seen in, hopefully in a slow motion video, how violent everything was, and you'll understand why I do that. Basically what you want to do is you want to get it so the gun is on the target, the crosshairs are on the target, and then we want to remove us from the equation. We do not want to be part of the carriage right now. We want to get this gun shooting the best, the most accurate that the gun can shoot. We've already went through and we've gotten a hold of the right kind of pellet because we bought our straight shooters pack. We're either bought a scope that has the adjustable objective and we're eliminated scope shooters parallax. We discussed that in a video. And if you don't understand the straight shooter pack or the scope parallax, you need to go review them videos before you get to here. I'll put links up to them. But now we understand everything. We're gonna let this gun be as accurate as it can be. So when I'm shooting it, I get up there, I don't even put this hand on the gun, I put it right here, I go like this, and I don't grip here very hard. All I'm doing is just kind of bracing my hand so I got somewhere to pull the trigger back to consistently, and I slowly pull that trigger back, get it, if it's a two stage, you know, suck up that first stage and then deal with the second stage, pow, we shoot the gun. And we do that, 5 consecutive shots. We go down there, we look at our groups, we adjust our scopes accordingly, and we get this gun shooting the best it can possibly shoot. Now comes the shitty part, because we're going to put ourselves back in the equation. We are going to become part of the gun. What sucks is the human body is not made to absorb shock. It's made to resist shot to get things back straighter. When you're shooting a gun, you know, we always are taught with a rifle, you get your high-powered rifle, hold it tight to your shoulder, your shotgun, hold it tight to your shoulder. With a pellet gun, that is not what you want to do. That, the tighter you have this gun to your shoulder, the more you're pulling here, the more you're holding here, and then you're kind of fighting them crosshairs to get straight and get on target. And then when you pull that trigger, the gun goes off and your body's already adjusting and holding that recoil and the pellet hasn't even left the barrel. That would be awesome if our body would do that exactly the same every single time, but it won't. It'll do it different and that pellet will leave the barrel will be in a different spot every single time. That is where shooters have developed the artillery hold. If you watch precision shooters shooting offhand, you know, they're always, they got a sling wrap and they're just like this and they got their hand rested here and when they pull the trigger, boom, the gun goes into the recoil exactly the same every single time. Their body, they're relaxed. They're not letting anything be tight, so they have to, their body's not going to adjust. So you have to do that with these pellet guns due to that double recoil. So when I shoot them, you'll see me grip the forend, or you'll see me just get a light hold on it. And when you see me grip the forend, it's just like this. I'm going to let that gun ride in there. That's all I'm going to do. Back here, that this right here is this here, basically with a rag. It's soft. When you go up and you're hunting squirrels or sparrows and starlings, you want to kill all them sparrows and starlings we can. They're invasive. But you get up there and you're going to rest on a tree or anything like that. Put your hand between the tree and the gun. Put your hand between the tree and the branch. Don't just come up and rest this on a branch. It's not going to be as accurate as it is here. Next thing is, we have to become this. We have to hold the back of that gun up because we don't want to pull it tight into our shoulder with our front hand because our front hand has to be loose. So we just get it up there and just get a nice, loose pistol grip, get everything loose, get a nice grip, be nice and relaxed, whatever you got to do, however you got to hold the gun. I know my buddy Ron, he holds it just like this, you know, and he shoots amazing. Just get it, whatever you got to do. Do the breathing, get it on, boom! And then let that gun go through its recoil process without you becoming part of the gun. You have to become that carriage. You have to either allow it to roll back or you have to allow that barrel and everything to come back, just like on an artillery gun, you know, them big artillery guns. That's what you have to become. It's hard to master the artillery hold, but it's not hard to be recognized that you have to do it and be good with it. It's not hard to be good with it. It's hard to master. Especially because it goes through everything opposite of the way we were taught when we were shooting rifles. So that's basically it. Once you become good or, you know, understand the artillery hold, your groups will start getting a lot tighter, a lot better. You know, shooting that right pellet, now we're on to, we understand the parallax of the scope, and now we got the hold. This is everything you need to become a good, great, and an awesome pellet gun shooter. Thanks, guys.